Good evening, good afternoon. Thank you very much for the opportunity to be here. We can say Strastujte. So I'm Kim from Budapest, and I'm working on there on the Semmelweis University as an assistant professor in cell analysis, but also working on this company on behalf of the scientific and technological development 3D HISTECH. The interest that we have to make molecular diagnosis is coming from the medical practice that you do and that I also do and did in the last more than times. But in the practice of pathology, and especially in the field of molecular pathology, we have to see that the work of your daily work is very much related to imaging. Image registries, image data bank, which is today mostly done in the days in your brain, in your head. So what we develop and we're developing, it's really an imaging support way where all of the steps where you are doing an imaging registry and imaging memory in your brain, then we are able to make the same image and store in an in a information center. And later on, we are able to retrain and to reevaluate these images and prepare for a report. But especially in this presentation, I would like to talk about more on the molecular pathology imaging, which is, I think, mostly difficult for you, because the molecular imaging for the fish, for the fluorescence, is done in a dark room. It's done, you know, in a very often by a biologist and done in several colors, so it's difficult. And this is what we think that is coming no more and more in our work, that morphology, yes, it's necessary to make the primary diagnosis. Immunohistochemistry can help us. But that field of the molecular visualization, the molecular detection of genetic alterations in tissue level related to heterogeneity, related now today more and more therapeutical decisions, are done still in a very simple way. I would say not rudimentary, but we think with the digitization of the fish analysis and the fish scanning, this is something that is bringing for the new world. So the digital microscope that we developed, and let me tell you that 20 years ago, we tried to do it in Budapest for our research purposes. Simply, we collected all gastric biopsies, colon biopsies, and wanted to see, you know, on a whole slide how many number of positive cells we have. That we wanted to do the image analysis on the whole slide. And to make it, you know, we had to make digital slide scanners, and we had to develop a digital slide concept. And later on, we have to be able to define, you know, to area of interest and quantify these alterations. But this is, as you see, basically morphology or immunohistochemistry related. But very early days, it turned out that the fluorescence and the fish imaging could be a special field. Because looking into the fluorescence microscope, changing the filters, you know, going into the depths of the focal planes, it's really a very tedious work. So the first application of digital slide scanners was in the immunofluorescence, where we could put together all the channels, if we labeled in DAPI, if we labeled in FITSI, or even, you know, in the red channel, all the different stainings together, and we were able to put as well the different focal planes. So the digital microscope today is coming, you know, I think, over the optical microscope. Namely, if we see this digital enhancement, this is a digital DIC. And this is, you see, how it enhanced the cytological imaging of that slide. And this is the three different imaging types. You see, we can make a traditional bright field image. This is the DIC, a digital DIC enhanced. And this is even, you know, this special colored a black and white DIC image that we can also produce. So basically, with the digital microscope, I think you have a much more handsome opportunity to work than in the optical microscope. And this also includes, you know, the reference slides, it includes the reference scoring schemes. But we have a special problem in the fluorescence, because in the fluorescence, one focal plane is usually not acceptable. You have in your 3 to 5 micrometer section the labeling or the red or the green probe in different focal planes. And you have to find and move up and put together in your brain where is and how far they are. But if you consider the digital microscope, which can scan in different focal planes and then put together into one sharp extended focal plane, the different labels together, you have really a very clear image put into this one single digitally enhanced focal plane. But the stainings usually are not so nice. you have really dark areas, you have noisy areas, you have backgrounded areas. And with the optical microscope, we have a limitation. The resolution of the optical microscope is 5 micrometer, but the nuclei are 12 or 15. So what we see in the microscope is always somewhere distorted, somewhere damaged, but with a digital microscope, we can come further. Namely, we can really make 8 to 12 micrometer sections, and from that, we can prepare, perhaps, can we switch off the light? Because these images will be very dark, so it will be much better. And you will see, you will be able to compare a traditional optical microscope image, or if you go further, into a confocal image. Why we think is coming for us? As I mentioned to you, today we are practicing 5 3-micrometer sections, because the optical resolution of the optical microscope is up to 5 micrometers. And this is, you know, this is something that we see, because that image and that information in the optical pathway is added together. If we speak about a confocal image or a confocally enhanced image, you can see really without the background noises, you can see the clear signals. And this is something similar. In the fluorescence microscope, you often very see such green or blue or red dots, which are overlapping the cells. And with the autofluorescence compensation and with the confocality, it can be simply taken out, filtered out, and make really red, green, blue images for really analysis. And why it is again much better what we think than the optical microscope? The fluorescence labeled slides are becoming distorted in the light, so you have to work in the dark room. But with the digital microscope and the digital slide, you can do it before every monitor. It's very nicely enhanced and it can be further evaluated. So a traditional problem why we go further fluorescence digital microscope into confocality is the thickness of the specimen. So in the specimen, if you think about, you have photometric labeling, fluorescence labeling of different chromosome segments, which are, can be on the top or on the bottom of the nuclei, and then you can see such a distorted image, and then you can consider if you would have really sections from this 5 micrometer, around 500 nanometers optical sections, then we would be able to see sharp images, and we can decide, and we can quantify, and we can enumerate where are the signals. And this is where we went further into confocal fluorescence imaging, namely that we allow, and with the confocal technology, from the top of the specimen under the until the bottom of the specimen to take optical to make optical sectioning to visualize and quantify it. How it was done? Perhaps you see, once you have such a digital slide, or and from that you have a digital image. It's coming, I hope. It's not moving. Yes, so you see now, I'm sorry, try to get back. So from that confocal image, we can make a three-dimensional reconstruction of the nuclei, and in the three-dimensional reconstruction nuclei, we can determine the size of the probe, the distance of the probe, and not only, you know, making the numerical determinations. So our problem that in the cell, if you look on that with a traditional optical microscope and the traditional fluorescence scanning, we add all the signals which are in the different focal planes together, and we detect it by a camera in the end. But it would be much more details in the resolution and in the labelings and in the fluorescence if we would have this optical sectioning. And this is not so easy to do, because you can imagine we are moving here around optical sections, 500 nanometers, 300 nanometers, and we would move in X and Y range around 2 to 3 millimeters. So the early confocal techniques use the single pinpoint solution, namely, once you have your specimen here and you collect the photons from the different focal plane, which is coming together in an added focal plane together, which will be very quite noisy. But if you do confocality with a pinhole, like here, then you will see only one focal plane coming from this point. And all the other photons from the other focal planes will be out of the focus, out of the detector. And this is the principle of the traditional confocal microscope, that you have a laser beam, you illuminate one focal section, and then you detect one at one focal point. But this is for histology, it's not applicable. It takes very long time, it is very tedious. So the next generation of confocal scanners were using such a pinhole disk, where the spin hold is determining for us the same focality, but for a large area. So this was invented surely by a Russian scientist, Nipko. So this Nipko, this basic principle, was the first which could be used for a large field whole slide scanning technologies. But we went a little bit further. We applied, you know, such a called structured illumination together with a water immersion automatic pipetting. Because in the fluorescence, not only the dimension, not only the z-depth is a question, but also the resolution of of this optical setting. And with a normal objective at 40x, your resolution is somewhere 0.25 micrometer per pixel, but we need here for molecular labeling, for the small, small tiny dots, a larger resolution, somewhere around 0.15 micrometer per pixel. We speak about here 150, 120 nanometers, which could be applied only by using, by increasing the resolution by water immersion. And this system are using very scientific CMOS cameras, which allow for us really the whole spectral detection for the fluorescent dyes. And it was very important for us to, again, to allow for label-specific illumination. The traditional mercury-halide lamp that we are using in the fluorescence microscope activate all the fluorescence channels, which we are filtering by an optical filter. But if we are using LED lasers, which we can really adapt and we can define according to our fluorescence labelings, for the different fluorescent dyes, it makes for us a switch-on opportunity that this labeling is not dying, doesn't get vanished out of the time through. So we are using and we applied, you know, such a LED laser illumination unit, which is coming from the Lumencore company, where we have six different LED lasers, which we can define based on the different dyes that we are can be selected either from Abbott or either from Deco or from other companies for the different molecular labelings. And this is where we are now, that we wanted to develop an automatic fluorescence, high resolution, multifocal, multi-label, multiplex slide scanner with the implication of automated water immersion pipetting. Then where we are really using an objective cleaning as well, and then we are using a dark field preview application to see where is the specimen on the slide before the scanning, that we enhance the speed, that we are using an enhanced spinning this technology, a structured illumination where we are really optically a larger resolution than the optical microscope, and this digital resolution is really applicable for molecular labelings, and then we have a fast scanning. And we have a clear background compensation for each layer separately, that we have that we don't have autofluorescence, and it can go up to 100 focal planes. So Hungarians like designs as well, like the Russians. So we try to really develop the world's first ever confocal slide scanner system, which includes, as you see, a lot of different components, a lot of electronics, a lot of optical components. But we also implemented it, you know, in a closed housing. It means that for this fluorescence digitization today, you don't have to have a dark field room. It's simply in the same room where you are making your stainings with inside two hybridization chambers. And then once you have done it, you can put it into the scanner and you can define the different scanning opportunities and then can you do. But the scanner, as I mentioned to you, is first one, yes, it's a fluorescence confocal scanner. But it includes also a fluorescence scanning, a traditional fluorescence scanning, and a bright field scanning. So it's coming now out, the confocal, the bright field, the traditional fluorescence scanning. And this was for us a really breakthrough development, as we first time we had a black and white imaging system used either for the bright field, so hematoxylin-eosin state specimen, and also for the fluorescence, including the automatic water immersion pipetting for the all Z stacks. And this is now coming in the world together, but let's see how it is working. So this is a brain section from the different molecular cells. It should work if it is a film, but I don't have it. And then, this is the film. Can you try it for us? Click on this slide. No? Sorry. This is the Russian parliament. And then you see the different dyes, the green, red, and blue. As we switch on with a very high resolution. And then it's coming the image export that you can use it for your documentation and image analysis. That would be also a three-dimensional reconstructed six-section from 50 micrometers. And this is something I think is quite unique, that you can have really the different labeling, the dappy, the green, and the red together. And this is available from your digital microscope, from your mobile phone, from your mobile assets, and you're from a home office as well. So how to make an image is not only hardware. We had to work, and we are working still very a lot, to make a background compensation, that we filter out the background noises, that we are allow you know to see the small, tiny details, and then allow even more channels, multiplex labeling in the different slides, not only two, like the Fitzy and Green, but Psi 5, Psi 7, or Aqua even as a further labeling channel for us. So these are some sample images. And it shows for you where we are doing the image analysis and how do we do the image analysis. In the different channels, if we separate the colors, we can define the different peaks of the single labelings. And this is that we can count, that we can determine the intensity. And this is what we brought together. So once we have here the autofluorescence compensation, you see, with a simple mathematical algorithm, we can see more in details, we can enhance and sharp the image, filter out the background noise, and this is not available in the optical microscope. And it's important that the slide scanning is not the doctor's job. It's really your assistants, it's really your the nurses in the lab who could use this scanner and to make the digital slide, and you from your office, from your screen, you can have a look on this digital slides from the server. Now let's see the image analysis software, because once we have these signals, we have to calculate, to enumerate them structurally and in the numbers. So numerical and structural alterations we have to be able to detect. So this fish analysis software, as it is working on a digital slide, can evaluate much more nuclei, much more cells than in the traditional optical microscope. The diagnosis today for the different fish probes, for the different diagnostic labelings, are supporting or requesting to count 200 slides. This is the maximum. Here we speak about several thousands of cells that we are scanning in the time through. And for the single cells, we have now a morphology like a flow cytometry evaluation opportunity that after the segmentation, the single nuclei, they are put into the gallery. In the single cells, the labelings are quantified and they can be filtered. You can look for the highest number of structural alteration, the highest number of numerical alterations. You can take a look on it. You can check it whether the calculation was done rightly, or you can delete from your calculations. And in the end, your molecular diagnosis is done on several hundreds or thousands of cells, not 200. And the results is basically different than on a pre-selected field of view. And this interactive work after the slide scanning, as I mentioned to you, the slide scanning could be done by your assistants. Then you can make list cell number determinations, and in a larger number of cells, you can define the degree of heterogeneity. You can really also evaluate the different degree of the genetic heteroploidy. And this is then is coming through for the different determinations of alterations, and then you have your slides always with you. It's not losing its stain, it's not losing, you know, in the time, it's really like the gallery, then you can check. It's interesting to see that this digital slide-based fish analysis is getting now overtaking in the world against the single field-based image analysis in the different fish systems. So the traditional optical microscope-based fish analysis systems, like the meta systems or the applied imaging, are also going now towards the digital slide scanning and doing the different color channel evaluations. So it's showing to you how many cells we calculate here, evaluate here. And this is the different categories based on the different evaluations on normal ploidy or different number of chromosomal alterations for the different cultures. It has to move on. So for the different probes, you can, different their labelings, define different algorithms, you can apply on the different slides, and finally you have really an evaluation, quantitative evaluation of the number of cells, and you have these plots, and you can, these galleries, and you can see it inside, and put it in somewhere in a case report, together. So I'm saying that my time is running, but we started this for doing research. After this project first successfully closed, it turns out in the world that other colleagues, other laboratories would like to have, and spinning out from the university, we established a 3D histec company, which is now producing the digital slide scanners, perhaps in the largest number for the largest diversity, and we are proud and we are very happy that also in Russia these systems are used. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Bella, very much.
Do we have any questions to the speaker? Please do.
Thank you. In English, thank you very much for this nice presentation. I suppose you showed us completely ready, high-resolution setup, right? There was previously talking about disadvantages of that kind of analysis, like pretty heavy file content. Mm-hmm. And does the setup you proposed has higher or lower size of final images, or it's the same grade, mm-hmm. 5 gigabytes or something?
Yes, it's a good question. Thank you very much. Basically, such a multi-channel, multifocal planes slide is coming up to several gigabytes. After can be 100 gigabytes.
So about the same.
Yes. So the solution is today that we've seen in, you know, in the last years that the storage opportunities are growing. So from this year on, you know, we delivered or we installed slide servers or scanner computers with 12 terabyte hard disk, and next year it will be 150. So the details need the resolution. The focal planes need the channels, yes. The more labels, I need the space. But the time is working for us, both on the screen, the Ultra HD monitors, and both on the storage.
Yeah, I think it won't be a problem also. And the second question, does this setup needs any another way of sample preparing, or it's completely the same as is common for fish method?
This is the same, but it could be enhanced, as I mentioned to you, to do the fish labeling on 6 sections. So 8 to 12 micrometers. Where you would have really whole nuclei. That could, you know, change the labelings or the staining, mm-hmm. but as we see, it's worse, because then the nuclei are really intact.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Bella. Mm-hmm.